Universal God, we thank you for the many blessings you have bestowed on our nation and community. We ask that your love and guidance be upon us, we act in our homes, our jobs, as fellow neighbors in this great community. Amen.
Thank you. Be seated. And if you'd please make sure that you silence your cell phones. We do have all five commissioners present tonight for a 100% quorum. You've had time to review the minutes, gentlemen. Are there any changes that you'd like to make to the minutes as they were submitted?
No changes.
Thank you, sir. So can I have a motion for the approval of minutes from April 18?
So moved.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor? Motion to approve carries 5-0. We do have one item that we need to add to the agenda tonight, Mr. Vice Chair.
Mr. Chair, propose to add item D1, preliminary plat for Robert Wilson.
Are there any other items that need to be added? If not, can I have a second to the motion?
Second.
Do I hear a second? Any discussion? All in favor? Motion to approve the amended agenda passes 5-0. Before we begin, I'd like to take a moment to clarify that the Planning Commission is a recommending body to the Columbia County Board of Commissioners. The decisions made on rezoning and variance requests tonight will be forwarded to the Commission for final action on May 21st at 6 p.m. in these chambers. If you wish to address the Board of Commissioners at their meeting, please see Ms. Jennifer Neal, and you can obtain a request to speak form from her. We're a little less formal, as some of you know, some of you may not, in these chambers. If you'd like to speak for or against a particular issue in our public hearing, raise your hand. We'll ask you to come up to the dais, and we'll give you 3 to 5 minutes to give us your view and opinion. If you would have a comment you'd like to make on an item that's not on our public hearing agenda tonight, we'll have an opportunity at the end of the meeting for public comments. So with that being said, we'll move into our first issue tonight. Ms. Hall, I believe we have 3 massage operators licenses to consider tonight.
Our first one is Elegant and Exquisite Massage Therapy. Alicia Mike Harper is the massage therapist. She meets all the requirements. She will only be providing mobile massage services. She's a little different than some we've had in the past. Her home is actually in the Grovetown city limits, so she's received her occupational tax from there, but we're not approving her to perform massage there. Only in our jurisdiction mobily.
Gentlemen, do you have any questions? Not a public hearing, so we'll need a motion to approve, deny, or to table.
Take the motion. On H2A1.
Two.
Approve. I'm sorry.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All in favor? Motion to approve carries 5-0. Ms. Hall.
Our second is Michael Martin, doing business as Martian Wellness. He will also be mobile massage services from 4246 Deerwood Lane. He meets all the requirements, and I recommend approval.
Okay, gentlemen, any questions? Motion to approve, deny, or to table?
Chairman, I'll make a motion. Martian.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All in favor? Carries 5-0. Ms. Hall, last one.
Our final one, Sandra Simmons. She is also mobile massage. She's from 5755 Carriage Hills Drive. She meets all the requirements.
Gentlemen, same. We'll need a motion to approve, deny, or to table. Sir, could I ask you to take your hat off, please? Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I move to approve item H2A3, massage operator's license for Sandra Simmons.
Do you hear a second? Second. All in favor? Motion to approve carries 5-0. Thank you, ma'am. Appreciate you. Okay, the first item of business tonight, we have a provisional home occupation for Georgia Farmstead, Inc., and we have been asked to table this until May 16th. However, we are going to have the public hearing because we'd like to get input on this. So if there's anything that the staff needs to know, we'd like for you all to note their concerns to give to the applicant. With that being
said, this item is not a public hearing.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. But still, have we heard from neighbors?
We've had some previous complaints from neighbors with this property, but as part of the concern with the request. I don't know that any of them are here tonight. Okay. Since this is not a public hearing, it's not advertised.
Okay, I'm sorry. My mistake. Okay, Ms. Bolte, could you give us a rundown on this, please?
Sure. This is a provisional home occupation request for Ms. Jeanette Norris at 4856 Columbia Road. She is proposing two separate businesses on the property, the first being Barnyard Buddies and the second being the eggplant. The property is on the south side of Columbia Road. It is currently zoned R1, which is single family residential. The property to the west is zoned similarly as fairly large lots, but to the north and to the east, we have more typical neighborhood type developments, Baldwin Place being zoned R2, and then the Amherst planned unit development to the north. This is the aerial of the property. You can see the existing house. Ms. Norris does live on the property. That is one of the requirements for our home occupations. With the provisional that allows her to request permission to use areas outside of the home as part of the business, in this case, she is proposing, first of all, the mobile petting zoo. She does have existing animals on the site, existing paddocks and pens where they are kept. We are pending some additional information from her on this business. She has some additional licenses that we do not have copies of that would be necessary from the Department of Agriculture and from USDA. We also do not have numbers or counts of the animals, which could have an effect on whether or not she can maintain the animals on the property in a way that doesn't create a nuisance for the neighbors. And the larger the number of animals and the denser they're populated, the more upkeep and more care is necessary to avoid odor and noise issues. We have had previous complaints to the sheriff's office and to animal control with loose animals in Baldwin Place neighborhood and with barking dogs. She has gotten rid of the dogs that were barking, gave them away, and she has put up a privacy fence against Baldwin Place to help address some of those issues. The other business request is the eggplant, which would raise and sell chickens and ducks and other fowl, as well as some of the eggs from them. He is proposing up to 150 adult juvenile chickens and with an additional 100 hatchlings, which is a fairly significant number of birds on the property. She has submitted all of the licensing she needs for that business or copies of those. With the R1, the single family zoning, one of the limitations on agriculture in this district is it does forbid poultry houses and the commercial sale of meat and eggs. Well, that's not to say that a small scale egg sale business couldn't be appropriate in R1. With a total of around 150 chickens, we do have some concerns that that is exceeding what could be considered small scale and may fall under that that prohibition on agriculture in R1.
What's the current code for R1 for the number of feathered varmints you can have?
On parcels under an acre, you can have up to 6 chickens. There is not currently a number limitation beyond that. So at this time, we are recommending to table this application because we do not have information, particularly on the mobile petting zoo side, that we feel we need for a complete review of this request.
Gentlemen, any questions? Okay, this is not a public hearing, so we'll need a motion to approve, deny, or to table. And I believe if you choose a motion to table, they've requested May 16th.
Chairman, I make a motion to table provisional home occupation for Georgia Farmstead until May 16th.
Second.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor? All opposed? Motion passes 4-1. Neil, we have a temporary use authorization.
Yes, sir. We have a request for a temporary use authorization at 6087 Ridge Road on 1.09 acres. It's currently zoned R4 recreational residential. This shows the location of the site. That R4 zoning. This is the aerial of the site. And they're just requesting to put a 40-foot camper on the X on the aerial while they are in the middle of building their permanent house. It is going to be an expectation of about 30 to 60 days before they start the construction of the house. And staff recommends approval.
Gentlemen, you have any questions? Not a public hearing, so we'll need a motion to approve, deny, or to table.
Mr. Chair, I move to approve the temporary use authorization, tax MAC 034, parcel 017.
Do I hear a second? Any discussion? All in favor? Carries 5-0. We've got our additional item tonight, preliminary plat, Robert Wilson.
Yes, sir. This is a preliminary plat for a property off of Knob Hill Farm Road, currently zoned R1, single-family residential, and this is just three lots. Ordinarily, this would not come before this body, but they are extending public sewer to these properties, and the extension of the public utilities requires a major plat review. This is the location of the property at the intersection of William Few Parkway and Knob Hill Farm Road. It was rezoned in 2012 to R1. And they are subdividing in accordance with the restrictions of that district. They are extending sewer to the lots, so the minimum lot size is 30,000 square feet. Per zoning conditions, they are prohibited access to William Few Parkway, so all of the driveways will be off Knob Hill Farm Road, and they are showing the no access buffer on William Few Parkway. Staff is recommending approval.
Do we have any idea how they're going to interconnect the driveways? Are they going to do a shared lot? Or a shared driveway between 65 and 69 and a single drive?
Are they doing a shared drive here, and then this last lot will have its own driveway.
All right. Gentlemen, any questions? Not a public hearing, so I'll need a motion to approve, deny, or to table.
Mr. Chair, I move to approve the preliminary plat for Robert Wilson.
Second.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor? Approve carries 5-0. Ms. Bolte, Whispering Pines, Section 3.
Yes, sir. This is the final plat for Section 3 of Whispering Pines, located off William Few Parkway. It does cover several parcels. 75 acres is the location of the site. The extension of the main entrance road to Whispering Pines leading back to this new section. This is a total of 118 lots, with a minimum lot size of 7,150 square feet and an average of 9,148. That is in line with the requirements for this planned unit development. Minimum front setbacks are 25 feet from the right-of-way, with minimum side setbacks of 7.5 feet and minimum rear setbacks of 10 feet. Sidewalks are required on both sides of the subdivision roads and are provided along one side of the extension of the main spine road. This section contains just over 25 acres of passive open space, as well as the 7.3-acre amenity area here off of that spine road. This is a bonded final plat, so construction is not complete at this time. Staff is recommending approval, with the note that all of the departmental comments do have to be addressed before the plat will be released from plan review.
Gentlemen, any questions? Not a public hearing, so I'll need a motion to approve, deny, or to table.
I'll make a motion to approve item H2 on Whispering Pines.
Second.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor? Carries 5-0. We have no plan revisions. We do have two items on our public hearing tonight. First is file RZ190501. Mr. Butler.
Senator, sir, this is a request for a rezoning off Gateway Boulevard from M1 and R1. That's a split zoning to S1. For medical mixed-use campus. This is the location of the property on the north side of Gateway Boulevard. Current zoning of the property, again, adjacent properties, you have a mixture of M1 and R1 to the east, same thing to the west as well. North across I-20 is R1. On the south side is all R1 as well. So there's an aerial view of the site. This one over here is not part of the rezoning. That's actually a cemetery for your information. And again, the plat of the property, again, showing the cemetery. So this request is for a medical mixed-use campus. So the question is what is that? Well, what you have is a hospital, clinical professional services, professional services, and then health retail and professional within a mixed-use campus. Again, it's a 50-acre site. At full build-out, it's anticipated to be nearly 1 million square feet, 910,000 square feet total. The initial proposed development, and the applicant can kind of go into what may happen with their phasing of project. The initial is a 100-bed hospital, which is here. We also had a 75,000 square foot clinical professional service, and a 50,000 square foot professional, and then 6,000 square feet of health, retail, and professional. The hospital at full build out would be at 300 beds, 600,000 square feet. The clinical professional would add an additional two stories, where it would be at full build out 125,000 square feet. Then professional would also be five stories, 125,000 square feet as well. One thing with this, the hospital could be as high as seven stories or 100 feet. It has been reviewed by our fire department. They're totally fine with that. In terms of uses, there is a long list of uses for this site. They include commercial, professional, basically runs the whole gamut of uses you could have in here. Part of that is this is a complex we really haven't seen before, where you have a lot of different uses all together. It's more of a health campus for the area. In terms of lot and structure requirements, the setbacks are 90 feet from Arterial Street, 60 feet from a collector street, 55 from other public streets, and then 10 feet for a private street here. They also have a side setback of 5 and a rear of 10. In terms of parking, the site could have as many as 1,700 parking spaces. And with the development standards on the site, they submitted a guidebook for how they're going to do this development. It lays out, you know, different materials. You can see them here, as well as the different heights for each thing, also what they could look like. One of the things with this, they don't have final designs on a lot of this. So again, this kind of gives us an idea of what it could look like, what materials they're going to use. Gives a framework to work within. This is the hospital and associated uses here. The next one, you have the medical office. You have the health, retail, and professional shops and offices. So in terms of the actual, if we go back to the site plan real quick, the one thing with this, it is supposed to be a very walkable development. We worked in conjunction with the design team from the hospital to kind of go over some of our concerns with it. One of the things is the Gateway Boulevard, you can see on this drawing here, will continue to go to the east there. So one of the things that we have off of Gateway Boulevard then is more development, whether it be commercial, perhaps residential. So one of the things there is, how do you connect all this together? This development, they have a stated goal of being pedestrian friendly. They're going to have walking trails throughout. You can see some of them here. They also are going to connect to the multi-use path that's on this side of Gateway Boulevard. So it should provide a very good idea of how to do a mixed-use development in this area for the future. Again, staff is recommending approval of this request. In terms of the future land use map, it is within the Gateway Activity Center. That kind of that area does have commercial uses within it. It fits perfectly within it. It says mixed uses are preferable. So we have no concern. Recommends approval.
Thank you, sir. Gentlemen, do you have any questions, staff? This is a public hearing. Is the applicant here this evening? Okay. Would you like to come forward and give us any additional information? I understand y'all might have a presentation you'd like to make. No? All right. Thank you. This is a public hearing. Is there anyone here that would like to speak either for or against this particular rezoning? Seeing none, I'll close the public hearing and accept a motion to approve, deny, or to table.
Mr. Chair, I make a motion to approve file RZ190501 rezoning from 2S1 for medical mixed-use campus off Gateway Boulevard.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Session? Been a long time coming. It's going to be a tremendous use for the property, and looking forward to working with you guys on an ongoing basis on this. I'm sure we'll be seeing you again through the process. And if there's anything we can do to help you guys along the way, feel free to call. I know staff is ready to work, and so are we. So with that being said, all in favor? Approve. Carries 5-0. Last item in our public hearing tonight, file RZ190502. Ms. Mister, I believe you're going to start, and Ms. Bolte, you're going to finish. Okay.
Yes, sir. This is the file 190502. Its location is 5001 High Meadows Drive. On 49 plus acres, and the current zoning is RA residential agriculture, and the use is residential, and the request is to PRD planned residential development. Here is the location plan, and it's off High Meadows Drive. across from William View Parkway. And the zoning map shows that the RA zoning that's surrounding, plus the other developments, which are planned unit developments, Polari on this side, High Meadows Pud, Ivy Falls. Here is a close-up of the aerial that shows the property with the existing house and ponds, and you can see the existing trees that are on the side, and here is the gas easement across here. The aerial view, just to show you the context of where the property is, and the plat. So for a planned residential development, it is required to have a concept plan and narrative. And we've had several meetings with the applicants during the process, and the final revisions were given to us last week. This is the concept plan, and some of the changes that were done were the connections to Polari here, which was a stub out on that side of the development anyway. Connection to Misty Woods Drive here, and the main entrance, which is off William View Parkway here. The overall residential development has 158 lots. 81 units are actually an alley access type, which is from here. The other ones are a 74 have a road frontage and a slide by drive. All the lots are proposed to be a minimum of 5,000 square feet. The front setback is 50 feet from the center line and 20 feet from the alley. The rear setbacks are 10, and the side setbacks are requested to be 7.5 feet to help create a neighborhood character to that, similar to Northridge subdivision in Evans, which is what this is based on. So the PRD requirement is 10 feet, but with the proposals, the applicant can request a smaller side setback with justification. The part of the proposal did require architectural standards, but that was discussed, and the applicant would like to do that at the later phase. That is actually a requirement of the PRD, so that is something that still needs to be worked on. Some of the information provided for the character of the development, you can see the photographs there on the left-hand side showing a selection of house types with potential garages or carports style there. The narrative to describe the architectural standards is obviously one of the missing elements of this submission to date. In terms of the overall site layout, you've got a 50-foot buffer around the perimeter of the site, and all the streets, all the roads have street trees, and the alleys are the sections across where the blue shaded lots are. There's a natural pond in the center of the site, two stormwater ponds are designed in, and there's four open spaces that are accessible to all the residents to provide passive amenities, including benches and swings. The overall, there's about 11 acres of open space in the site. The utilities will be provided by Columbia County, and the sewer system is proposed to be a force main system. And there are some details still to be worked out with the utility department. Overall, the lot count is 158, which gives a density of 3.2 units per acre. In the future land use map there, you can see the yellow for representing the neighborhood's character area, which is required for established neighborhoods to preserve established neighborhoods and create the new quality new construction. Future development in that area is proposed to be between 1 and 4 acres. Some of the concerns have been listed by staff in the report and given to the applicant, and part of the PRD request includes the submittal of a concept plan, and that will be in detail by Danielle.
So the first part of the concept plan submittal is the existing conditions map, and the reason we require this with the concept plan is to ensure that what is designed is feasible on the property. If you're not aware of what's out there, wetlands, floodplain, things like that, obviously that's going to impact the design of the project. So this is the existing conditions map we received April 22nd for this development. It does show the topography, it does show the state waters at the back and the existing pond in the middle, as well as an existing spring. This was reviewed by Connie Smith, our floodplain manager, and she indicated that there are environmental features on this property that are not shown on this map, including showing that the pond is wetlands, showing the buffers required around the state waters, showing the floodplain and floodway on this plan. The FEMA maps are under revision also, and it does appear there may be some increase in the floodplain on this property from what is shown on our current online county maps. So those are all missing items from this existing conditions map that need to be addressed in order to ensure that the concept plan being submitted is tailored to the property.
So the site plan we've seen probably is going to change significantly based on the features that we found.
Significantly is relative. There may be some modifications to it, particularly lots that are backing up to current floodplain. If that floodplain moves, that could potentially affect lot count or feasibility of putting lots in some of the areas. There are also some other requirements in our code that haven't been shown on this plan. Those have been listed in the staff report for the applicants. We do have a couple photos of the existing site. It is largely wooded at this point. And this is from the end of the cul-de-sac in Misty Wood. So this is looking into the property from the end of that road. Their concept plan currently is 155 5,000 square foot lots. Primary access is off William Few. It is a mix of public roads and alleys. They have done a pretty good job of interconnecting the roads. We don't see cul-de-sacs, we don't see dead-end streets. So we do have an overall interconnected road pattern. As Nana mentioned, this will be on county water and sewer. Currently, the plan is a lift station in this corner that pumps the sewage back out to connect on William Few. There is also a possible option to drain the other way into Killary and tie into their existing sewer system and lift station. That is a detail that remains to be worked out. They have submitted a plan also showing that their proposed house footprint fits on all of the lots with their requested setbacks. We do still have a couple concerns with the concept plan, with specific areas of it, with the design. The first area is this corner here. We do have, this is an intersection in the neighborhood where the main travel path of the road and the alley is not perpendicular. It does create a bit more of a design challenge. This is also an intersection point between some of the street-facing lots and the alley-loaded lots. What we end up with is we have this first alley-loaded lot. They've addressed this by facing it out to the main road. But these first couple alley-loaded lots here end up facing basically into the backyard fences of the street-facing houses. The applicants have proposed to address this basically by covenants ensuring that the fencing material is consistent. The intent of the plan and kind of the goal with the alley-loaded lots was to face them over green space, so they are all faced out over some kind of park space. In this case, this is a very narrow angle at this point. You have very minimal green space for these homes to actually front on. So in staff's opinion, this is probably not the best design for this location. The other area of concern is the front part of the property. This area is primarily alley-loaded lots. They are fairly long alleys in this section, up oddly. But we have one, I'm going to draw them in because they're not showing up super well on our projection here. But that is a good bit of pavement. These are some of the longest alleys we've seen in the county. And it is only the second time that we have had alley-loaded lots that do not also front on a public street. Alleys are required to be private, which means they will have to be maintained by the homeowners through their HOA. One's had to deal with that. Maintaining roads is fairly expensive, and the longer the pavement length, the longer the road, the more expensive that gets. So that is a bit of a concern with the amount of and the length of the private alleys in this development. Long-term maintenance could be a problem. We also have this row here of street-facing lots within this primarily alley-loaded section. This is the green space in the middle that the alley-loaded lots do face onto. It is fairly narrow and, again, does put them kind of looking at the back of the street-facing lots there. That is, again, to be addressed through consistent fence material is the way the applicants have proposed to address that. There was also a fence shown on this section, kind of blocking off that green space from the homes on the alley. Our thinking is that the intent was to kind of screen what would be the rear of those alley lots from the park area. We're not sure a fence is the best way to go about doing that in order to kind of keep that park space more open. There may be other options for handling that area. We also had I realize I drew this in just so you don't think it was a mistake. That is a dual alley across the gas line easement. They obviously cannot pave directly over that line. So there is one alley on the north side to serve these lots with a loop to serve these ones. And what that does is it allows there to not be driveways on this main entrance into the development. So it does give a more pleasing streetscape on that entrance. It is a bit of a unique design, but that is something, I mean, the unique design feature is something we encourage in the PRD. The concern is simply the amount of paving. The other issue that has been brought up is the street sections. We do require these to be provided with the concept plan. We've seen issues with utility layouts with street trees and sidewalks in the past that we do try and address up front. At this time, neither one of these sections is approvable through our stormwater and water utility departments. We also have some concerns with the public road access from a planning and traffic calming standpoint. They are proposing a fairly wide public roads in this development, about 30 feet of pavement. The intent is to allow on-street parking for visitor guest parking. However, they have also noted that with them being slide-by driveways, you do have a long driveway on the street-facing lots, and even the alley-loaded lots can hold at least four cars if you account for a two-car garage and driveway. So they don't really expect people to use the on-street parking very much. However, they are providing the space for it and anticipating that it will be a traffic calming feature. This seems a little bit counterintuitive. And with the wider roads, if people are not, in fact, parking on the roads, that does encourage a higher rate of speed than we would like to see in the neighborhood. So we do have some concerns with the design on our end. And then Water Utility has provided comments as well, indicating that they are not comfortable approving the sections as submitted. So we did provide a list to the applicants of information that needed to be provided to update the concept plan and the narrative accordingly to make sure the street sections work, that they match with the concept plan and the narrative. So we have a cohesive concept for this development. With the PRD, the planned residential development, we are looking for a coherent design concept between the narrative and the concept plan. And at this time, we don't feel like the applicants have quite achieved that goal. So we are recommending to table this application to give them a little more time to put that together. Yes, I'm sorry, that was long.
I've done this a little while. Have y'all ever had a plan submitted that has had this many issues?
Yes.
I don't ever recall one coming to us. Y'all may have dealt with it before it got to us.
Well, and I think that's the key here is that typically like to take care of these things before the application is submitted. I don't know what happened to the timeline on this one, but There still are some.
Gentlemen, do y'all have any questions?
Go ahead. I yield, Mr. Dempsey.
Would the alleyways be as wide as the streets?
No, sir. The alleys would be 20 feet wide, pavement width, so they would
streets be... Streets are 30.
Streets are 30. So the alleys would still have the 20-foot. They would have sufficient fire department access, which since that is the only access to a lot of those alley-loaded lots, that's an important consideration.
So if they use alleyways for parking, it could be...
That is part of the narrative. There will be no parking on the alleys themselves. That will only be on the public roads.
But they also list in the narrative that they don't think there'll be parking on the public.
Correct.
Well, I can tell you there will be. Having lived in a neighborhood like this and having a side slide-by drive, somebody's got to park on the road if there's more than two or three vehicles. So I don't see that as a plus in the narrative. They're not being honest with themselves. They're not being honest with us.
One more point about fire department access is, have they actually looked at the department? Have they been brought in to look at the layout of the roads and alleys?
Yes, sir. The fire marshal has reviewed this plan, and he's stated that with the statement in the narrative that they will have no parking on those alleys, they've met all of his concerns.
Thank you.
For lots 1 through 7, you know, the narrative also states that the alley-loaded lots face green space, but lots 1 through 7 face the road. Was there given for that, aside from
that was actually a recommendation from our traffic engineering department as a way to make that entrance a little smoother, a little cleaner, and not have the driveways off that main road.
Okay. On the Force Main, we're going to have two options possibly: Force Main or gravity fed into Killary.
Right, and that would tie into an existing lift station in Force Main. Water utilities indicated that would be their preferred route for them to go, but with the current lot count, the lift station they're showing is feasible.
How many lots does it take to before the county take a lift station?
At least 150.
Force Main's a lot of maintenance. Awful lot of maintenance.
Any other questions? Yeah, this is a public hearing. Is the applicant here tonight? Yes, sir. And just for the public, we have been asked to consider tabling this until July 18th. And what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and conduct our public hearing so that any concerns you have can be noted in the public record for staff to communicate to the developers. All right. Yes, sir. Please give
Commission,
us your name.
Thanks for your time this evening. Staff, thanks for all of your time throughout this process.
Please give us your name and home address.
Rhett Harbison. I'm 1296 Broad Street, Augusta, Georgia. Worked for Johnson Lash Urban Associates, representing the developer of the property. Thanks for your time, staff. Thanks for all your process throughout this. It's quite an ordeal to get everything that's required for PRD. I don't think there's a set list, and it sort of triggers one thing after another. So it takes multiple meetings to get everything set up for this. One concern was the timeline and the incomplete application. We apologize for that. We were up against a due diligence period of buying the property. In that meantime, the developer had a death in the family, had to leave the country, so we had some family matters. So we wanted to get this submitted and wanted to get the process rolling so we could know how to proceed with this so he could meet his due diligence period. I think a number of the concerns that the staff has is concerns it's particularly to the utilities and the stormwater is that that'll have to be addressed during the permitting process. And from reading the report, this meets the Vision 2035, and it meets the surrounding areas of Columbia County's master plan. So I think the zoning of it fits. I certainly agree with a majority of the layout concerns the staff has, and we'll definitely look at revising those and resubmitting those for the next, when we propose to table this to the next meeting, to the July meetings. So that'll give us time to really dive into the existing conditions plan. There's some confusion on my end on what's really required there. Is it going to take an engineered survey to go out there and locate all the trees, or is a simple Google Earth and GIS and FEMA floodplain coordination acceptable. I've sort of heard that go both ways, and I don't think an engineering survey should be required for this parcel, just because that would be approximately a $30,000 survey that the developer would have to purchase, not knowing whether the zoning would go through or not. So I feel like those concerns can be addressed through GIS maps and FEMA maps, and just updating that existing conditions to get a little bit.
John had originally requested July 4th, but I believe we're going to probably cancel that meeting and move you to the 18th.
Yes, sir.
Should we get a motion from one of the gentlemen here?
Yes, sir.
Questions? Thank you, sir. We may call you back up. This is a public hearing. Is there anyone that would like to speak either for or against this particular rezoning? Yes, sir. In the back, you had your hand up first. Please come up and give us your name and home address.
Good evening. My name is Jeremiah Ashing. I live at 178 Misty Woods Drive.
Would you spell your last name, please?
Certainly. It's A-S-H-I-N-G. And so it's right there at the end of Misty Woods on the west side there, at the right up against the proposed development. So my wife and I bought the property about 6 months ago, so we've lived in the development just a little time. We moved down from Chastain Place just up the road there on William View Parkway. We specifically were looking for rural agricultural. We looking for a place where we can have a little extra land, perhaps some animals later on. And specifically for some place at the end of a road, looking for a little less traffic. So looking at this subdivision, specifically the concept plan given and the density of lots, it has a drastically different zoning than rural agricultural. And I think those different zonings carry different expectations. So I know the neighbors of mine on Misty Woods Drive have a certain expectation with the rural agricultural. And then I guess the proposed residents in the new subdivision would have a different level of expectations. We've already heard a little bit about the calming measures, traffic calming measures there in the new development, and some of the wider roads. With the connection to Misty Woods Drive there, I can tell you Misty Woods has none of the traffic calming mechanisms that we look for. So there's no sidewalks. It's a straight road down with one curve at the end. A few hills limiting your sight distance. And overall, you're just going to see a lot more children and adults and rural animals in that roadway. So I suspect if you introduce this many individuals coming through with that road connection there, you'd see just a different level of expectations. And that's where in the staff report where we notice criteria 2 and 4, where they really look at the impact on existing neighborhoods and the traffic. When viewed independently, I agree with the assessment that they're both acceptable within the 2035 vision. But when you compare them with each other, the traffic compared against the impact on existing neighborhoods, I think it does look at creating an additional burden to the existing residents of Misty Woods Drive. And so with that one for the first comment that I've got, I just ask that the commission and the proposed developer just look at plans that do not connect Misty Woods Drive to the proposed development. My second comment would be on the floodplain. My property was built in 1986 with the current floodplain in mind, and the property's butted right up against the shaded X FEMA hazard map area. So, and you can see it kind of right there. And so if that floodplain were to rise, it would encroach in my actual structure. And so that worries me to some degree. If that floodplain rises, I suspect there would be their flood insurance or something I'd have to get. That worries me a little bit. The last comment I had was the proposed trail that may or may not be there, the planned trail that may or may not be there, that abuts the property there and runs through the, I suspect it's running through the 50-foot buffer. If that were that, looks right in the back of my house, coming around that corner. It's a beautiful area. I love the idea of having a trail there. I think it's smart of the developer to do that. But ultimately, I would ask just for some thickening of some sort between that trail, just as a bunch of travelers walk around my backyard. They're not interacting too much.
All right.
Thank you, sir.
Appreciate it. Is there anyone else that would like to speak either for or against this particular rezoning? Yes, sir. Please come forward and give us your name and home address.
My name is Carlson Hayes, and my address is 179 Misty Woods Drive, and I have a problem that he didn't express on his property. The former owners had to spend a lot of money, rock, both sides of the ditch after it goes under Misty Woods Drive. I showed him a few days ago where the water level now, like it's normally coming through, small amount of water, but it is not going through the culvert under Misty Woods Drive. It is running along the outside of the culvert, and if you increase that flow, the road's going to be washed out. The road is not built for that much heavy traffic. And then pond that they have shown, well, I've cut all that field and everything next to it and the drive down to the property that we're talking about. And the little pond drains into the pond that joins my place and theirs. And then the overflow from it goes through a 6-inch PVC pipe. And high water, and if they put any more water in there and got all of these streets and the alleys, it's going to flood out the dam, which my property line is on top of the dam. Cut that up long after the pond was built. So I feel like that there's going to be a major outfall somewhere in there, and then that ditch has got to go under Misty Woods Drive. And it's already eroding out underneath. So I don't know what they're going to do about that, but they have put all this up, and they don't show the true facts of the water. I know what I've seen when we had that 5-6 inches 3 years ago. It was overflowing onto my property. Little 6-inch pipe that overflows, it won't do it. Overflow. This is a major problem that they haven't been out there and looked at.
Is this something stormwater will address?
Yes, sir. That will be addressed with the design of the subdivision, all the calculations for the runoff created to make sure that the three ponds they're showing can contain the water that would run off of the site.
There's no way. You know, they'd run right into the one that joins my property and the people that own the 15 acres on High Meadows there that I was talking about cutting the field and everything. All that field and everything draining in there. When they put all that pavement over there and your concrete, that's no way. And there's been nobody out there. I have not spent that much. I've been around the property a lot this year, and there's been nobody out there surveying anything. They have taken a flyover map.
Before any finalized plans at all were to be done, this would all have to be addressed on the final plan.
Well, see,
exactly what you're talking about, and through the engineers and through their department. It would not be left as is if it's a major water problem.
Well, this property across the street, he paid a contractor to rock in these 8 feet up from the bottom of the ditch up, and now that goes through his front yard. And all he was telling you about traffic and all on Misty Woods Drive, it won't take, not a heavy duty road, it'll take a lot of heavy traffic.
The county's not going to allow development that would destroy Mr. Woods Drive and or any of the properties right next to it. I mean, all this will be addressed in the proper time before any final decisions would be made.
Well, that's what it says. It's going to be some major work done property that doesn't belong to them. Go through my property. I've got 2.25 acres there, and that ditch takes up a good bit of it, and it's going to be washed out.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Sir, are you across the street from the previous speaker?
Right.
Thank you.
And see, the former owner of that property paid Larry Norris he spent several days in there hand placing these rocks in that ditch. Because whenever we had that heavy water, it was a road, makes a turn, and it just erodes it out.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Yes, sir, the gentleman with the glasses. Yes, sir. Would you like to come up? Please give us your name and home address.
Mark Birdsong, 107 Misty Woods Drive. Everything that they said is absolutely true, and particularly with the nature of our neighborhood. It's been there for 30 years. We were there when nothing was out there. That's why we moved. Not saying they shouldn't be able to do what they want to do with their property. That's their property. They can do what they want. But keep their property on their property and away from us. don't connect it to Misty Woods. Or as you're saying with the engineering will take care of the flooding, I disagree. When they built up all of neighborhoods around Misty Woods, I live at the top of Misty Woods. I have a 12-inch pipe that goes under my driveway. Well, now the 12-inch pipe can't handle it. When it rains, it goes over my driveway and floods my front yard out now. So I don't believe what you're saying about their engineering will take care of it, because they
I'm
certainly
sorry,
did
you don't
my
have
house.
Any more trust in us.
Well, it made it worse at my house.
I guess we'll just have to wait and see about all that, won't we?
Where's your house at?
I'm on the second house from the top.
Well, when you say from the top, what does that mean? Can you?
At the entrance.
From High Meadows.
Can you mark on the, go back to the,
back
give
to
us an
the,
right there, give yeah. us an idea where you're at.
Right there.
Thank you.
And you, in the neighborhoods you're referring to are the ones?
When they built up everything across the street, when I moved there, that was a cow pasture. When they built all that up and changed all of the runoff.
Water utilities throwing water on you?
Yes. Now the 12-inch pipe that goes under my driveway can't handle it, and it washes out my front yard now.
You had any conversations with anybody at the county about that?
Yeah, I did, and their answer was basically, since it's not a constantly running stream, there's nothing they can do about it.
So if this was your property with the star on it, wanting to sell it and develop it yourself, what would you do to appease?
Oh, I'm not saying they shouldn't be able to develop it. If I'm not trying to say the guy can't make a living. He
understood,
can do whatever
but
he wants.
The question is, what would you do to appease your neighbors? What would you have them? Because the water, if they decide to develop the land, the water runoff is going to be addressed by the county. But as what you could, if you could control anything in a build, what would you say?
I just don't want them connected to our neighborhood.
No connectivity.
It's a rural neighborhood. We have horses. We had an alpaca farm there for a while. Kids are on the road all the time. It's just not suitable for through traffic.
So what you're asking for is no connectivity?
No connectivity is what I'm asking for.
Okay.
That's not going to make any difference to the water, whether we connect or not.
I was hearing two
different. That's not going to address that problem.
Well, I was hearing two different things.
I understand.
Thank you, sir.
Is there anyone else who'd like to speak either for or against this particular issue? Yes, sir. Please give us your name and home address.
Ron Carmichael, 142 Misty Woods Drive. And my concern is all this is fine. My concern is the traffic, the connectivity from Misty Woods Drive into this proposed neighborhood. That's my concern. It's going to create a lot of traffic on that road. That road, I don't even think it's designed to have all that traffic. So the connectivity is the issue with me.
I've ridden out there, and I just got to wonder, how many folks are going to leave this neighborhood, drive down Misty Woods to get out by the water utility to come back out to William Few Parkway?
Well,
is that reasonable? I'm not saying it is or it's not. I'm just wondering if folks will actually do that.
Well, I think
shorter route to go out.
I think they will with all that traffic up there. This goes up to Baker Police Drive, right? This property.
Well, if it connects through Killary, it could go out to Baker Place.
Yeah, and with all that traffic up there, I'm sure that there will be a lot of traffic coming back through Misty Woods Drive to get out of there, to get to Columbia Road quicker. I really believe that.
Take a left out of your neighborhood, straight to Columbia Road.
Oh, yeah, very easily.
Would it help you guys out to have another way out?
No.
Because you've been there 30 years, but
yeah.
You know, one of the things that the commissioners task us with is to try to get interconnectivity. So if there's an issue with one entrance, we've got another way to get emergency vehicles in. And I'm not saying that's right, that's wrong. That's just what they've asked us to try to do in as many opportunities as we can.
But we've been there all this time and had no issues with that.
Sure.
And we've had emergency vehicles in there. So And
I'm not saying it's right or wrong. I just said that's what they've asked us to try to do. And again, there have been circumstances where we have taken connectivity out.
They overruled.
And they've overruled us.
Really?
So, yes, sir.
Back about a month ago. I was the one who made the motion.
Well,
overruled us when it got to them. That's just a point.
Well, that's the big issue. And I've talked to other people, other neighbors of my neighbors in there, and that's the issue, is a big issue. I know that the two at the end have much bigger issues than that, right. But the connectivity and the traffic we're concerned with.
Okay. All right. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else who'd like to speak about something besides traffic? We've heard a lot about traffic. Yes, sir. Please come up and give us your name and home address. We understand that. Please give us your name and home address.
Opportunity to say something. And I'm going to say something that's...
Please give us your name and home address.
I'm John Shirouse, 152 Misty Woods Drive. A concern I have with this is we talk about the fact that for all these years it's zoned as a residential agricultural property, and many people have invested their lives in it. And as a county, we're doing something, especially in my neighborhood, where we're coming in and we're building a lot of houses on a little bit of property. I firmly believe in the right of a person to develop their property and make a profit off it. But sometimes I constantly look at the information that comes out in the county documents, especially the water bill that comes out monthly. And month after month, they talk about high-density, building in high-density properties. And yet, we keep on rezoning property that was, I think, rightfully zoned residential, agricultural, or lower density, and yet we keep going to high-density housing, which creates all these problems with the infrastructure in the county. And I think we have to look at who we're here to serve. We're here to serve the people who live here, not just the people who wish to develop their property, because it affects all of us. And that's my concern, is the constant rezoning to a higher density level of folks, which creates infrastructure problems. Thank you very much.
Yes, ma'am. Please give us your name and home address.
My name is Betty Sue Hodges. I live at 153 Misty Woods. But I'm also concerned about the other road going in on Baker Place. I've got six grandchildren who live in that neighborhood. And for the last 2 years, the two youngest of my grandchildren weren't able to go to Baker's Place Elementary because the school is already overcrowded. How is this going to affect the high school, the elementary schools, with all these houses coming in? How's it going to affect the kids? We're already overcrowded in the school system as it is. How is it going to affect with more people coming in?
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else? Want to give people plenty of opportunity here. Yes, sir. We make you the last. Yes, sir. Please come forward and give us your name and home address. Feel the same way. You ought to be in one of these meetings that goes 3.5-4 hours.
Don't get old. Yes, I'd like to
please, see. Please give
something.
Us your name and home address, please.
My name's Tom Ash. I work with Blanchard and Calhoun Real Estate. And at one time I was known as the land man in Columbia County, and I'm proud of what I've been able to do over the years. Straight out of college, June 61, I started in real estate. I've seen a lot of changes. Some of them you wish you'd have never seen. But due to people like you and due to people that are trying to do what's best, a lot of land's been developed. And it's going to continue to be developed. I started Woodbridge in 1971. People didn't like it then because there was too much traffic. Washington Road was 2 lanes. And it's a common complaint that everybody has. I don't see how anybody can like
some of the congestion that we have to put up with anymore. But the schools nearby this particular property, one reason they're there is because you got a good road system and you're close to the interstate. And too many of us don't appreciate what we've got. And we've got a good county. We've got good people that try and put in a good day's work. We've got a lot of newcomers that have moved here because they didn't like it where they were. Well, one reason they didn't like it where they were is too many people. So I'm not advocating that we get rid of the people because I'm one of them. But over the years, I've been involved with 56 subdivisions. And I knock on wood, they've all been successful. And that is that a lot of them I turned down because I didn't think it was the thing to do. Who am I to be thinking things like that? Well, they might have taught me something in school. I was in the first graduating class at the University of Georgia in real estate. And at the time, all I could think of was getting out of school. I wasn't a good student. But I, over the years, I've enjoyed working land. And it takes people that appreciate it to sell land. You got to know what you got. This piece of property is an excellent piece of property. All we were asking for was zoning in order to do all these things. You can't go and spend $30,000 or $40,000 studying a piece of property and not knowing whether you're going to get the zoning or not. And anyway, the project ought to be tabled. There ought to be some conditions that county isn't going to approve the use of the land till you meet those conditions. I don't see how this is a pet zoning that the county has been looking forward to have to help them save problems in a little bit higher density. To get the owner fair market value, you've got to figure out how to use land. And it isn't up to me to tell y'all how something ought to be done. We've got a good engineering outfit to study. There's been four different plans that have been provided on this property. Each time, one's been done to satisfy what the Planning and Development Authority thought that ought to be done. For some reason, there never was a cul-de-sac on Misty Woods Drive. It just comes to an end. Why wasn't there a cul-de-sac? If I went to develop a property, they'd never approve it without a cul-de-sac. But now, when I first talked to the county, well, we don't want you to use Misty Woods Drive. Then they come back and say, well, we want you to use it. So there's another plan. There's been a number of things that have happened. The owner or the buyer had family troubles of illnesses out of the country. And he stayed over there a long time. He came back, and the day he gets back, he found out his brother had died. So he turned right around and went back out of the country.
Mr. Ash, I'm going to ask you to wrap it up.
Okay, but I just want to say, we all in the same boat. Let's figure out how to do it. Ms. Shields, that owns the land, she's got a right to use her property. And this use to PRD is one of the plans that the county came up wanting you to use. So why can't the county help the buyer and the engineer figure out how to do it?
I believe that's what the process is.
It's really pretty simple. Thank you, sir.
With that, I'm going to close the public hearing. We've got some information that we can forward on. And again, when we reconvene with this issue on, again, if this is tabled on July 18th, we'll reopen the public hearing so that whatever new has been done to adjust the plan, y'all will be able to weigh in and give your comments either for or against that revised plan. So with that being said, we'll close the public hearing. Gentlemen, I'll accept a motion to approve, deny, or to table.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion to table file RZ19-05-02 until the July 18th meeting of the body.
Do you hear a second?
Second.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor? Approve the table to July 18th. Passes 5-0. That's our last item on the issue tonight, or on the agenda tonight. We have no legal matters. Got staff and commissioner comments. Mr. Strickland, I believe this is your last meeting with us. Andrew's last day with the county is going to be on, I believe, May 12th?
10th.
And May 10th. And he's taken a job to be the assistant city manager of Anderson, South Carolina. So it's going to be a nice step up for him. We appreciate the work you've done for us and the vision you've given us and the leadership you've displayed both to us and to the staff. And we're going to miss you and wish you well.
Well, I appreciate you saying that. No, it's been a good almost six and a half years. Yep.
You're the sixth division director I've been through.
I'm happy
not sure
to,
if that speaks
happy
well.
To help. I say it a lot, but I'm happy to help.
The common denominator there.
Yeah. No, and I think one of those folks that Tom was talking about was probably me. So, I appreciate your hard work. This is a thankless job a lot of times, and you guys don't. Thank you for all that you do.
Sure. Gentlemen, anything else? Any other staff comments? Okay. Got public comments. If there's anybody that would like to come up, tell us something interesting that we don't know, then we'll know what you know. If not, I'll accept a motion to adjourn.
Move to adjourn.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All in favor? Motion to adjourn passes 5-0 at 7:06 p.m. Next meeting is May 16th at 6 p.m. in these chambers. Thank you for coming out.